only update provided by Jordan. We walk down the path there.
Good afternoon. And even this scorecard, everybody knows it. To make this, easy and to follow and also relatively brief, I'm going to walk you through the city's legislative package that you laid out and what's going on with each of those items. And I'll try, like I said, I intend to be brief. If you have questions, let me know. If you'd like that follow-up, we can do that. The first item in the package was dealing with combined sewer funding for combined sewer overflow. As you know, the governor, in his introduced budget bill, provided $40 million in bond proceeds for that project. In addition, budget amendments have been submitted by Senator Watkins to push that amount to $78 million, and by Delegate Posse and the rest of the House delegation to push it to $115 million. We've been working that pretty hard. The administration is trying to enlist some of our business allies and the local business allies in this. We've also been spending a lot of time on the General Assembly building working the issue. Just to give you an idea of how fast the short session is going to be moving, 2 weeks from this coming Sunday, the budgets will be reported by the Appropriations Committee and the Finance Committee. The next one dealt with the payment of taxes. Quinn has introduced House Bill 1812, which deals with the issue you had in your priority package there, and that's been referred to the House Finance Committee. The next item is study of school funding. We don't have a member of the delegation introducing this study, however, Senator, and for various reasons, but Senator Sasslaw, who's the minority leader in the 2020 Senate, I'm not sure you have a majority leader. Dick Sasslaw, who's the Democratic floor leader in the Senate, has introduced a study resolution, and I'm confident it'll get out of the Senate. I'm not as, quite as confident it'll get out of the House. Some other items here that we had outside of these critical items that you had was elimination of the undesignated reduction in state aid for localities. That was a $45 million item statewide. The governor in his introduced budget proposed eliminating that, which is a really big deal for us. Full funding of the statutory requirements for state aid to localities with police departments or House Bill 599. The governor proposed level funding. We're working with the Virginia First Cities Coalition. Budget amendments have been submitted to have that fund grow consistent with the state's revenues, which is what it's supposed to do. Full funding of the state share of local social services administrative costs. We've not seen any legislation or budget proposals to do that at this time. Long-term funding source for transit. There are two issues there. One deals with the funding formula. There's been a proposal from the McDonald administration that would change the funding formula for transit to make it a performance-based funding formula. The GRTC would actually benefit from the funding formula. However, the Virginia Transit Association is opposed to it because the majority of the members would not do as well. Lastly, under those key items would be funding to bring high speed rail to Richmond Main Street Station, and there's been no proposal at this time. Going down to some items that you had asking for support for legislation to combat poverty and the effects of nutrition, so you had three items here dealing with food deserts, and Delegate McQuinn has introduced a resolution, HJR 646, which asks the Secretary of Health and Human Resources to study and report on the matter before the next legislative session to the Senate House Rules Committee. You had a number of items in there dealing with the Affordable Care Act, coming right and put them into two buckets. One deals with establishing a state health exchange, health benefits exchange. The second deals with the expansion of Medicaid. This is a moving target. We met with Councilwoman Robertson and Dougal the other day. We had a long talk about this, and since then it's changed again, as you saw in the morning paper. There have been several bills introduced to establish the state health benefit exchange, and the state cost of implementing the Medicaid expansion keeps dropping the estimated cost, the more they delve into it. It started out initially with over $2 billion was the estimate, now That's going to add to the push to go ahead and do the expansion. That will be a budget issue. We'll be done in subsequent legislation, be done as part of the budget amendment process if that happens. Other things you had in your package were to make clear that transient occupancy taxes and sales taxes are applied on room costs paid by the consumer for rooms booked through the internet providers, and the bill has been introduced to the Senate by Senator Wagner from Virginia Beach to do that. The Retail Merchants Association and the Virginia Hospitality and Travel Association are working on it pretty hard. It's too early to talk funny. Let's see, a couple of one that's been of perennial interest to the council is restoration of voting rights to convicted felons. As you all know, the governor came out and said the Commonwealth speech in support of that, and it requires a constitutional amendment. There have been several introduced in the House and the Senate. This morning, the House Subcommittee of the Privileges and Elections Committee, which deals with constitutional amendments, pretty much unceremoniously tabled all the constitutional amendments in the House. More to play out on that as they come over from the Senate. I think the votes are probably there to get it out of the Senate. You asked to oppose legislation reducing or eliminating local taxing authority, with particular emphasis on M&T or machinery and tools, and the big poll tax without a comparable revenue replacement. The chairman of the House Finance Committee, Bob Perky from Virginia Beach, is the perennial author of those, and he's put them in again this year, but he doesn't have the backing of the Virginia Manufacturers Association, which has had in the past, and working with VML and VECO, chance of turning those back once again. Last item I'd like to bring your attention is House Bill 1860 and Senate Bill 1236. 1860 is patroned by Delegate Orrock and Senate Bill 1236 by Senator Watkins. Essentially, it deals with the way that billboards are assessed for taxation. The billboard group has indicated that the city is the only entity in the Commonwealth taxing billboards based on a real property methodology that also incorporates the revenue derived from the income generation from those. And so essentially what the bill does is says you can only tax billboards as personal property, we're talking to the Virginia Association of Assessors to see if anyone else is doing it that way and what the best industry best practice would be. But the billboard operators have come out to this one, so. And you guys keep it short and there.
Thank you so much. Are there any questions for Mr. Jordan? Vice President Hoskins.
Thank you, Mr. Jordan. I appreciate your report. A lot of good information was followed up on some of those key items that we're very interested in. And I don't have a question specifically to get any of the information. Just wanted to know, is it possible that you can have a electronic copy of it?
That's what I was going to follow, but just for the new council members to know that every Friday afternoon, we have a meeting with the council president, vice president, kind of update them and get some direction from them as needed on items that have happened in the week and what's upcoming. And also, you'll get an electronic weekly report. It probably will come on Monday. Share that. I'll make sure Luke has that to share with the rest of the council members about that.
changes. And so we want to be sure that folks would know, I'm sure have noticed, when that happens, so that we wouldn't have a large group of citizens who buy only to find that this moved up and down or the date was changed. So we'll be vigilant if we're going to have a group of citizens and encourage them, as we should, to go out and voice their opinion about the expansion and other bills as well.
Thank you, and I would hope that any bills that we need to react to, you would have been talking about.
Yes.
You've
got
to
speak a little louder.
Okay. I would hope that any bills that we need to react to, you would have been us.
Oh, yes. The usual rule, Mr. President.
I think echoing a little bit about what everybody said is, we know that we're advocating for the city of Richmond with the General Assembly at this stage. We know that it's a very fast-shifting session, and things change minute to minute. As Newell's point, to the extent that we can get our citizens out there to advocate for these issues on behalf of the city, I'd love to be able to share that information.
And we'll do that the best we can, and we also work very closely with the administration.
Right. And I would say at the same time, when we know that there's an issue that's on the tearing point between getting us what we're asking for and possibly being shut down, those are perhaps the ones that we might want to put some of our resources at. Whereas if we already know that we've got 80% support in one issue, we need to continue to put all of our resources in that effort.